Welcome to part 2 of my series of videos on upgrading the Musical Fidelity Tri-Vista 21 Tube DAC. I didn't get it out as quickly as I had planned. Why is it that when you're busy, more work comes in? Of course, I did do that extra video comparing the part modded Tri-Vista 21 against the Core Hugo 2, and a reaction video in between. So what happened next with the upgrades? If you remember from last time, I mentioned more cleaning was needed. Check out the state of this cloth after cleaning out the inside of the top panel. Truly nasty. It was a clean new cloth before this. Remember I mentioned that the previous owner had already made some changes internally? I think it's probably worthwhile just running through those. An additional transformer for valve or tube stage power supply. The lead outs from the original transformer are isolated and tucked away. There were some mild capacitor upgrades, 4 green Samwells for valve tube reservoir. Bizarrely, they left Jamicons in the audio and digital reservoir sections. You will see now I've replaced all of those with some nice Nichicon gold tunes. They also had done some reservoir capacitor bypassing. And they used, I think, Panasonic EHG for local bypassing on the main DAC board. So around the valve tube stage, the current to voltage op-amp stage, the DAC and the voltage regulators. They also had used some Sanyo Oscons around voltage regulators. And all the op-amps have been replaced by Burr-Brown OPA2134s. I'm not convinced that those are the most suitable for the current voltage stage. I think that's a lot. So an okay start, but not really pushing the boat out with quality components. I also noted that some of the soldering wasn't up to the standard that I like. And the tubes, or valves as we call them here in the UK, have missing rubber grommet mounts and wire ties. I have a couple of sets of new tubes for this and new grommets, so that will be tackled later. Given that the op amps had already been changed and 10 pin dill sockets had been used, the next and easy upgrade for me was those op amps. As an indicator of original performance, I slotted in some NE5532s I had lying around. On listening, the difference is immediately noticeable. The soundstage becomes narrower and everything is just that bit more plain. As far as I'm concerned, that's fairly typical for this sort of op-amp. Burr-Brown's back and refamiliarize. Okay, now let's swap those out for a known good performer, the LM4562, and we'll put those in all around. That's more like it, plenty of detail. But is it missing something? Some of the warmth that the OPA2134s had? Maybe. So I swapped the output stage to those, and that's it. I know some people think that the Burr-Brown 2134s can be a bit warm sounding, overly warm sounding, but I quite like them. I've got a soft spot for them. I've used them in several places before. The trick is not to use too many of them, but they are very warm sounding, agreed, but they're also very open and spacious for an op amp. Really, I still think one of the better ones. I tried the OPAs back in for the current voltage stage, but that made things a little worse. I've heard before that the NE5532s are actually pretty good for use in the current voltage stage, so I tried those again. It was a while ago that I did that before filming this video, so I can't quite remember whether they were better than the OPAs. I think that was the case, but in any event, to my ears, the LM4562s did have the edge, so they stayed. I swapped all of those back and forth, maybe a half dozen times, until I settled on what I liked. 4562s for current voltage, OPA2134s for the output stage. I'll likely revisit that again later, once the rest of the upgrades are completed. At that point, I can reevaluate what works best with the component choices I've made. I also have in mind to swap out those op amps with some discrete alternatives. Next up was to change the bulk of the supply rail bypass competitors with much better ones. So, Panasonic FCs for the valves, Nichicon's best Muse KZ for various DAC supply rails, but also for the post-DAC op-amp stages. The ceramic bypass capacitors have also been upgraded with some nice Wima film caps. Put it back together again, and it's time to have a listen. What's happened? Well, those high-grade bypass capacitors have really made a difference to the background noise. You'll often hear people commenting about having a black background. That's what's happened here. The music emerges from a silky smooth darkness. Not only that, but there's more definition, more detail, more space. It's easier to place instruments around in the soundstage. If you saw my video on the comparison between this and the Cord Hugo 2, you'll remember that I commented that the Tri-Vista had a grainy edge. Not desperately bad, but just a bit of a grainy edge that the Hugo didn't. This upgrade step has reduced that quite considerably, but there is still a bit of grain there. There are more changes to come, which I think will address that though. The tempo was also snappier. I think the slow tempo was perhaps due to the previous owner using overly large capacitor values in a couple of places. That's solved now. So more tweaks to come, which you'll see next time. If you like this video, please hit the thumbs up. If you want to know when the next video on the Tri-Vista 21 or anything else I talk about is released, then hit the subscribe button and click on the notification bell. Thanks for watching. Take care. Hopefully we'll see you next time.